Okay, I think we are running a couple of minutes late because of some technical issues. So let's just get started, all right? My name is Leong. I think I'm going to present in English. I don't think there's an interpreter. So I'm not, so if I can speak Chinese, if you can ask questions in Chinese, I can reply in Chinese. But I think I saw some audience which is from, doesn't look like Chinese. So okay, I'm going to present my presentation in English. So today I'm going to talk about a blueprint and deployable solution for Open Cloud. So my name is Leong. I came from Intel. I work for Intel Data Center Group. I'm the chief architect for the Intel Data Center Enterprise and Government segment, China section, China division. I'm actually based in US, but many of my colleagues is actually based in China. One of my colleagues, marketing managers behind, sitting behind, a beautiful lady. So disclaimer, make sure you read through before I present. So what are we trying to address solving the problem today? So today we understand that we are facing a complexity of data. Data is coming from everywhere, right? So can we get a better performance, better system performance to ensure that your infrastructure is able to solve the complex workload requirements from your application perspective. So you need to, because when you deploy infrastructures, you need to satisfy the needs for the business application. So you can run your big data applications, you can run your Spark, you can run Redis workload, you can run database. But how do you ensure that those software layers can get a better performance out from your infrastructure? So that's one thing I'm going to talk about in the next few slides. And the other thing that we talk about is out of so many complexity, out of so many options, because we all talk about open source technology. And one of the advantage of open source technology is giving you the option to work in with different vendors. And also, there's a different hardware configuration that you want to put into your infrastructures, right? So how do you build out a hardware plus software, and those are pre-configured and they can meet your workload service level agreement? That's the second topic that I'll be discussing. And how can we, so out of this solution, the blueprint that I'm presented here, or we call a solution, is a pre-configured, a verified solution, the verified open cloud solution that can meet your workload SLA requirement. And how do you, through this, all the pre-configured and validated solution, help the enterprise IT to achieve faster time to value. Do I need to translate? 针对基础架构部署复杂的难题. So I'm not going to repeat that in Chinese. So basically, that's what I'm talking about just now. So having a better system performance, 更优的系统性能, 预先配置的, pre-configured, and validated 预先已经验证的这个开源云 solution, open cloud solution, and 缩短价值实现的时间. So today the workload, as I mentioned earlier, right, the many workloads are deployed on a cloud-based environment, including OpenStack Private Cloud. So the thing that I see on the screen right now is basically the reference architecture. I think this is familiar to many of the people who has been working in Open Cloud for many years. So what we're trying to do here today, we're not trying to create another different reference architecture. So this is based on industry standard, I mean, the open source, open cloud standard, the OpenStack standard, right? So what we're trying to do here is a software and hardware optimized layer. Because I'm coming from Intel, so you know Intel sells CPU, right? We don't sell software. But we work together with the software partner and the user to make sure that those software can get the best benefit out from the hardware. So we want to make sure, for example, all the CPU features, because in the Intel CPU, there's many features that it can use to accelerate or make your system, the workload, to run faster. That's one of the Intel CPU features that can bring it to you, including OmniPath, Ethernet, SSD, Intel FPGA. Those are the bottom layer hardware components that you can use, that you can apply throughout the software stack. So in this architecture, basically, we are combining the software and hardware. So So you have a compute hardware resources, you have a storage servers, right? You have a network servers as well. So how do we consolidate all these hardware resources together and then provide a software-defined infrastructure and given an open API and put all this resource together in a single unified management platforms? And it's scalable as well because we're not talking about less than 10 nodes deployment. We also talk about how can we achieve beyond 200 and 500 nodes deployment. As you can see on the keynote today, Shane, my one colleague, we talk about our collaboration with Inspur to make sure that we validate the OpenStack Rocky release version, the last previous release versions, that can be deployed across the 500 nodes physical environments. Okay, so that's one of the work that we work with them as well. In this architecture, we base on open source technology that include OpenStack, Kubernetes, and SAC. So throughout these three projects, we try to make sure that the hardware features can be utilized, optimized across these software, these three software components, including how do we optimize OpenStack with Intel CPU or in with some of the Intel new technologies, and also including storage. How do we optimize the Ceph multi-tier architectures using the caching layers, metadata, or how do we split the metadata and the capacity layer, including network. So Intel also have many products that can help you to optimize, speed out the network performance. So we, when we work on this blueprint or reference architecture, we make sure that all these bottom layers features is being passed through to that orchestration layer and the software-defined layer so that it can consume the hardware features, the hardware performance. Because when if you don't have a virtualization, if you don't have the container or VM, right, if you're running workload on a inside a bare metal machines, you can see all the hardware directly without any much of the changes. But when coming to virtualization, you're adding another layer on top. When coming to container, you're adding another layer on top. So when you add that abstraction layer above, right, you actually hidden some of the capabilities that underneath the hardware. So what we're trying to do here, we make sure that we work with the community, including the KVM, Linux community as well, Linux kernel as well, to make sure that all those hardware features, they are still can be seen, that can be used from the above the abstraction layer. Okay, that's what we're trying to do here. And as you see on this architecture, we the blueprint focusing on these two layers. So once these three layers is able to utilize those features, then the top framework, the framework and the platform and framework services and the application, then those applications can use the features that bring provided by through the VM container or even bare metal storage. So that's what we're trying to do here. Chinese translation. 开源云基础架构跟框架。 我相信刚才大家都应该明白我说的，所以我应该不用再重复太多的东西。基本上就是开源技术为核心 ，OpenStack K8 Ceph， 统一资源，弹性的扩展。然后最重要就是软硬件的调优。我们要做的东西就是做软件跟硬件的调优。我们不单单只是将整个硬件，我们不单单只是卖硬件，我们是要确保就是说。 这个在整个基础架构的建搭建里面，不管你是虚拟机、物理机、容器都好，它本身能够看到底层的这个基础硬件所带来的这个优势。This is what this is, 这就是我们想要做的一个事情。So deployable architectures. So it uses a standard most of the OpenStack deployment architectures. So usually we have a control plane, we also have a storage and compute plane, right? The data plane. So when we validate this particular solution, we use a small cluster to validate. So we took a minimum number of six servers as a minimum number. We applied three control plane, the controller servers, and we use three for the compute and storage, using this as a minimum cluster that we need to provide a more production server environment. So in this, we also using Ceph. Okay, so we put a Ceph monitor service together with the control plane, and we put the metadata and OSD services, on the Ceph storage nodes. So here you can see six different physical nodes and being managed through the three different layers network. So this is also a very standard deployment architecture, as you see from most of the OpenStack deployment. And that architecture actually can scale from less than 10 nodes to 200 and beyond 500 nodes. So we're not just talking on paper, we actually do the actual work. So there's a white paper that my colleagues is holding outside, so there's a, but the white paper is in Chinese version. So in this large-scale deployment, we validate the blueprint, the architecture with our partners such as Inspur, to make sure that we can apply that same reference design across 10, 200, or beyond 500 nodes. So of course, when you expand your number of clusters, the number of nodes per clusters, you do expect changes into some of the control, number of nodes that need to be allocated as a control node, the controller role, the role of the controller. So one of example here that you can see is a 500 nodes deployment. When you scale out that architecture, you basically expand the control node, the control host into five hosts. And we also split the network to a separate physical host and the database to a separate host as well. But the general deployment architecture still stands. You have the control plane, you have the data plane and storage plane. And over here, that 500 nodes deployment, you have two big clusters of compute hosts and another separate cluster for Ceph, the storage nodes. So that's the large-scale deployment. Okay. So we talk about the scalability. We talk about general architectures. So what exactly the component we use in this reference design? So I'm going to talk more hardware here. So in this reference design, for every nodes that we test, we make sure there's a CPU components. There's a memory, right? There's also storage. But what kind of CPU we can use? But of course, this is just one example. I'm not saying that you must use this particular model. You can also, you can even use AMD, by the way. So, but I'm not going to promote AMD, so because I work for Intel. They pay my salary. So in this model, we're using Intel Xeon, the second generation of the Intel Xeon processor. The Platinum series and the Gold series. So for the CPU, we are using the 6222V processor. The 6222V processor basically is a processor that is optimized, that is being optimized for virtualization network. That's why you see the V, that stands for virtualization. This particular CPU is optimized for virtualization on VM use cases. Okay, so they have basically they have more core that you can apply to the overall architecture CPU. The next one we talk about is storage. So storage basically means for the servers, the storage nodes, right? So on a storage nodes, how are you going to build out your Ceph architectures, whether you want to use a all-flash configuration or you want to use a mixed tier where you can put the Ceph metadata into a faster SSD, or you can, and you can put the storage capacity of the Ceph, the OSD, on the normal SSD. Or even you can have a mixed architecture with SSD and normal, the spinning disk as well. So, but in this different design, we chose Intel Optane SSD. That's one of the latest SSD that Intel is promoting. So that Optane SSD have better performance than the normal SSD. So we use that Optane SSD, the P4800 series SSD, as a cache tier. Basically, we run the metadata, the OSD, the wall devices, the Ceph wall devices, the write ahead lock devices, and the DB devices on the on this particular Optane SSD. And then you have the capacity, the normal OSD, running on the P4510 series SSD. So you have a multi-tier approach. Button. So the next one we talk about is the latest technology that Intel is coming out this year, I think early this year, which is the Intel Optane DC persistent memory. So this is a new technology that bridges the gap between memory and SSD. I forgot to put a structure here. So if you look at a triangle pyramid, so the bottom is, so the one of the bottom layer in the middle layer is the SSD. So SSD gives you storage capacity and some IOPS performance. But with before Intel persistent memory, after the SSD layer, that is the memory layer. Because memory is even faster than SSD, right? You process everything, you store, you need to store things, you either store in memory or you store in the SSD. But if you store in memory, if the system reboot, you lost everything, right? Because it's memory. And if you store in data in SSD, in persistent storage, if you reboot the system, data is still there. So, but there's a gap between these two whereby the speed of the SSD is not as fast as the memory. But memory cannot persist data. So that's a gap there. So this is what Intel Optane DC persistent memory is trying to solve, that gap. So Intel Optane DC persistent memory has two operation mode. One is what we call memory mode. The other one is called app direct mode. So the memory mode basically providing you a larger capacity of memory. So per CPU, if I remember correctly, the Intel depends on the series of the processor. I think the Gold and Platinum series, they can support 3 terabytes of memory per CPU. That means in one system, you can have 6 terabytes of memory. So that's a huge. And the cost is much more lower than DRAM. Because DRAM cost, if you put 6 terabytes of DRAM per host, it's going to cost you a lot of money. But the price for persistent memory, I cannot tell you the price. Because of legal issues. So the price, the price of persistent memory is definitely lower than DRAM, but giving you much more capacity. That's what we call memory mode. The second part of the persistent memory is app direct mode. App direct mode basically I forgot to mention, in the memory mode, the persistent memory function as a memory, function like a DRAM. That means that if you reboot your system, you still lost that data. Okay, because it's function as memory. It is a memory. But if you put us in that configuration, you need to have maybe you have a 1 to 8 GB of memory or 3 terabytes of persistent memory. The DRAM itself will become like a cache to accelerate your memory processing. And a DCPMN, the persistent memory will be using as a main memory. And that is transparent to the operating system. No changes is required. You plug in the module, plug in the persistent memory, you get that capacity without changes, no code changes. The second mode that I'm talking about here is an app direct mode. The app direct mode requires changes to the code because it actually write the data directly into the device, bypassing the system, the file system, normal file system. So give you a faster speed, near memory speed, and also persist the data. So that's where the app direct mode is about. If you want to find out more about the persistent memory, you can visit Intel booth. There's a demo that we prepare to talk about how can you accelerate data analytic workload with Intel persistent memory in AD mode, the app direct mode. And also, I think in the keynote, they also mentioned in the T releases, we already working with the community to upstream the virtual PMEM feature in Nova. That means that if you use Nova today, you can use the Nova PMEM module to manage the persistent memory as a virtual devices and expose that persistent memory device to the VM. Then your VM can take advantage of that hardware features. So this is a more detail for the control plane and storage plane. We use a lower CPU for controller because most of the processing is happening in a compute and storage nodes. There's 384 GB memory for this case. And in this case, we're using 1 TB of persistent memory. So we, as I mentioned just now, we use Optane SSD P4800 series for the storage cache, and P4510 as the storage drive, and also the NIC card. So this is just a reference design. Again, this is a reference design. It's just only for sample. You can change anything of this to meet your whatever workload need that you require. And also depends on your budget, right? So when we work on this reference design, we also make sure that using this kind of configuration, what kind of performance that you can achieve. So we're using this example, right? We validate the system with 3 different workloads. One is virtualization, because today we deploy OpenStack Cloud. Virtualization is one of the key workloads. The second is how does the storage perform? how many IOPS can you get out of this design? I mean, this configuration, with this configuration, as this example, okay? Of course, if you're using a different spec, you will give a you will see a different numbers. And so we validate the virtualization, storage, and also in-memory database. So we test these three workloads. Of course, there are many other workloads that we can test. And there's another workload that we just released. It's a Spark analytic workload. You can see at the demo booth. Okay. But on this presentation, I'm talking about these three: virtualization, storage, and IMDB. So for virtualization, as I mentioned just now, using this as a sample, because the size of your VM also determines how many numbers of VM that you can put on that host, right? So in this example, you can scale a normal host from 200 VMs to 1,000 VM in that cluster. So that cluster I mentioned just now is a 6-node cluster, 3 controller, 3 compute node. You can have more than 1,000 VM if, assuming your VM spec is 1 CPU, 2 GB of RAM, using this as a comparison. Of course, if you increase the size of the VM, you have to divide that size. Like for example, if you increase the memory to 4 GB, then you have to divide that numbers by half, okay. So this is one of the virtualization workload validated. And we also use, in this workload, we actually use OpenStack Rally to make sure that when we use Rally to spin out 1,000 VMs within, if you run the OpenStack Rally, right, basically you can specify your concurrency, the number of concurrency to spin out the VM, and up to 1,000 VM. So in this example, we use 100 concurrency. For the 200 cases, basically you can spin out 100 VM with, on average, every VM will take about less than 150 seconds. So in another words, meaning that if I need to spin out 200 VMs, right, because my concurrency is 100, put in simple words, within 300 seconds, 5 minutes, I can boot out 200 VMs. Okay, so that same, there are also numbers for 100,000 CPUs as well. On average, if we spin out 1,000 VM using a 100 concurrency rate, the average VM provisioning time, including provision the SIN, the volume, is less than 150 seconds per VM at 100 concurrency rates. Of course, you have if your concurrency difference, your VM's boot out time will also differ because your control plane, everything being affected by your network API control plane and KVM layers as well. The second workload that we validate is IMDB using Redis. So we use 16 GB Redis per VM. So okay, in this case, per VM, every VM is about 16 GB RAM running as a Redis instance. We use main tier client as a benchmark client to test this Redis instance. And in this cluster, the same cluster I mentioned just now, we're able to run from 20 to 60 Redis instance, 60 GB Redis instance, and they can give you more than 600,000 operations per second. And every operation is less than 1 millisecond. Because one of the Redis performance SLAs, you must complete that Redis operation. Every operation needs to be less than 1 ms. 1 millisecond. So using that reference design, this is one of the workload performance that we can achieve with that the earlier design that I put out there. The last one is storage. So storage IOPS, we're using VDBench, something similar to FIO as a benchmark tool to test that storage performance across the VM and the Ceph integration. Because when you test a VM, you need to attach. In this case, we attach 2 cinder volume, and that 2 cinder volume is being provisioned by the Ceph OSD, right? And in this VM, we have 4 CPU, 8 GB of RAM per VM, and we spin out 30 VM across that clusters, and run different kind of IOPS testing, including 4K blocks of testing, random read write. And in this example here is 8K block random read, more than 600,000 IOPS. Within less than 2 milliseconds per operations. Okay. That's the storage IOPS. So the last thing I'm talking about is, I mentioned just now the Intel, the persistent memory for Spark. It's a new feature that in T release. basically using Nova to manage the VPMEM, the virtual persistent memory devices. Because in the compute host, okay, you see that persistent memory as a region, okay? And that region is being sliced into different namespace. And every namespace is being passed through to the VM devices. So the VM devices will see the VPMEM device. So in this example, we have 1.5 TB of persistent memory. We slice into multiple namespace, and one of the namespace being passed to the one of the Spark instance over there with 256 GB, and the other one is no persistent memory. I don't have the data to show you here. I do have the workload SLA data at the Intel booth. Basically, using this workload as an example, the Spark actually using the OAP, Spark OAP, Spark SQL application to write the data into the VPMEM 256 GB. And if we use a 640 GB data size, because that data size over is actually more than the size of that VM and the persistent memory, compared to this one, you can achieve 30 to 50% faster query time in a decision support system. So that's what we try to do here, is to make sure all the Intel goodness features, right, is being exposed through the software orchestration layer, through the VM, through the container, so that the application like Redis, right, Spark, can take advantage of that, of those performance. So with that, I will close my presentation. Tomorrow, actually, we are officially launching a Intel Select solution for Open Cloud. We work together with different vendors, including Inspur, H3C, and we're also looking for many other partners to build this solution for the customers. We work together with partners and build this solution with the customers. We make sure that all these solutions with the partners is pre-configured, right? 预先配置的, okay? Is system optimized. 系统上已经优化的, 性能优化的, and we can, it's validated with workload verify, 复杂验证的, 一个开源云, open cloud. So that's what we're trying to do here. That's about my presentation. Thank you. Any question?
Thank you. You mentioned that you are using three controllers and three compute storage nodes as some basic amount of building blocks. And you mentioned that you are building this system and validated for 10 nodes, 200 nodes, and 500 nodes. My question is, there is still only three controller for 500 nodes.
When you scale, you cannot use 3 controller for 200 nodes. Okay, if you scale, you cannot use 3 controller for 500 nodes. No, that's not possible, because there are 500 compute. If you have 400 compute nodes here, they have 400 compute nodes. All the API requests, all those interface with the control plane. In here, you basically have, in this design, when you scale out to 500 nodes, we're using 5 controller, 5 Neutron, 3 database. So we actually also scale the control plane as well when the whole cluster scale. So it's not a 3 scale everything up. It's you scale accordingly. Depends on the workload. All right, thank you.
So I have a question. Regarding the, so we have a user scenario regarding the nested virtualization, because we kind of maintain our internal OpenStack CI, and we do see sometimes we need to, you know, disable re-enable the VTX for all models of the Xeon we use for Liberate to enable the nested virtualization. I'm not sure whether regarding that you have like specific models for us to adopt, or if you know what I mean. Yeah.
I mean, yes, we do have a few recommendations, but I don't have the figure to tell you right now. I don't have the data to tell you right now. We have a different teams that are working on those virtualization and VDX features. So the virtualization, but you're using the libvirt and VDX, those things, right? But if I mean, but your question is more like how, what kind of design? Okay. Yeah. So we need to understand what the problem is. We can talk about this offline. So we can link you to the people that, if you have a problem, because you need to, we need to know what is the problem, what is the bug, where it happens on, then we can try to fix that. Yeah. Without knowing the problems, I can't tell you the solution, right? Any other question? I think almost time. Yep.
You mentioned about the train being tested on the persistent storage. May I know what, I mean, what vendor of Vim supports the train OpenStack now that you use to validate the persistent storage?
So this is a new feature, and in T release, not many vendors support T today. If any vendors or software partners that require PMEM, we do actually test or backport that feature to Rocky. Yeah, but if any other vendors are interested in use any, but we encourage vendors to upgrade to T, right? Because OpenStack release cycles every 6 months, right? The longer that you wait, the longer that is more difficult. But if you really needs previous versions of PMEM support, we can talk about that. We can help. We can refer to the team to help to do backporting. But no promise right now. Any other question? All right. Thank you very much, and enjoy your lunch.